Alrighty, folks, here we are at the Marriott Vacation Club Pulse in San Francisco. I am bringing you another hotel, kind of a mini tour and room review. This whole video will kind of be a little clip show of my time in San Francisco. We were there for about a day and a half. Things did not go as we had planned or hoped, so it might not feature that many clips or adventures, but I'll still talk about it as best as I can. When you do get into the elevator, you do have to put in your room key to access the floors. The elevators do have hand sanitizer as well. The floor layout and design is pretty unique and it's interesting. It's a nice little design. We were down the hallway and the room itself was okay. I was reading some reviews and people were saying that it does remind them of a prison. We kind of thought it was more of like a army barracks or like a naval ship room compartment. Kind of cold, kind of not boring, but you know, not too much going on. You can see the Dock B sign. The beds are always clean and comfortable. We are on a major street, so they do give you a set of earplugs and talk about, you know, the music of San Francisco, which we didn't really mind. We're kind of used to sleeping with that type of noise, but we heard more through the walls. The walls are really thin. We heard babies crying, people talking loudly, and the TVs blaring. The room does come with your standard coffee and tea, this giant cabinet. It was interesting and pretty loud. You are about to hear the door opening, and you know, you do need to get some oil up on those to prevent the noise. We have the mini fridge as well. So yeah, that does get kind of annoying if you do open it constantly, but it's not really that big of an issue. We have a large door for the bathroom here. As always, the bathroom is clean. All the towels are fresh, no issue there. The shower was also big enough, and there is a tub feature as well. There is another Marriott hotel right across the street, and this pathway or this road takes you right down to Fisherman's Wharf. But before we get completely to Fisherman's Wharf, we did make a stop at Surisan. It's a Korean-American fusion restaurant. We had the soy garlic wings, the Millionaire's Bacon Flight. They were outstanding, some of the best bacon you will ever have. We have Korean short rib eggs benedict with absolutely amazing potatoes. They were so crispy and light. The bacon, each one had a unique flavor. The sauce and the wings were outstanding, and the wings were so crispy. And the pimped up ramen was fantastic, a little bit spicy though. And here we have the main pier area to Fisherman's Wharf. At this time, it was pretty early in the morning and there weren't that many people out, maybe a few joggers or people on bikes, but it was definitely nice to see it clean. There are a ton of vendors and homeless people in the area that do really make it dirty, so you do constantly see cleaning crews and street sweepers out there trying to clean up after them. There is Alcatraz, which you can see from pretty much any point on Fisherman's Wharf. And of course, the famous Buden Bakery with the best sourdough bread ever. They have a ton of different animals and designs and setups that they have to showcase all the art and talents of their amazing bakers. And the great thing is you kind of feel like you are at Disneyland and you can actually watch the bakers rolling the bread and forming the dough into these different animals. You can see the giant crocodile or alligator that they have made, and the baker was nice enough to flip around her tray and show us the little teddy bears that she has been working on. And they are there almost all day. I think anytime we did go, we did see bakers working away. And there are plenty of bread and pastry options. We love to just come in the morning and grab a few pieces of bread and pastries to have them with coffee. There is a Pete's Coffee attached, which surprisingly was making really good coffee. Some of the better coffee options that we have had from a chain such as Pete's. And we did like it more than the typical Starbucks run as well. You have plenty of different sweet and savory and regular bread options. There's also a small marketplace with chips and soups and cans, and a menu with the famous clam chowder in a bread bowl. You have to get that. And please, please, please don't throw away your bread bowl. We were seeing so many people eat the soup and just throw away the rest of the bread. Why waste the money and all that bread if you're not gonna eat it? It's just carbs, folks. You're not gonna get fat from it. Just eat it and walk it off later. but we do enjoy everything that we got. Here we have a simple blueberry scone, really well made, along with the cinnamon raisin bread. We did buy some extra to take home as well. It does freeze for up to 6 months and you just pop it in the oven. And here is our bread bowl. Decent clam chowder. The bread is really where it's at, nothing to rave home about, but you definitely get it for the bread. Down the street, there is Pier 39. It's just a bunch of restaurants and shops and kind of a tourist area, but still fun to walk around. I haven't ever eaten at any of the places here, but there is a Boudin location here as well. If you happen to be here or the other spot is too busy, they have the same exact menu. I just don't think they have as much variety when it comes to bread itself. If you want the actual bread, definitely go to the main bakery location that we were just at. And there are a ton of people, especially now with COVID. We were definitely masking up around these types of crowds just to, you know, feel safe and protected from for us and from one another. But some areas there are less crowds and it's less densely populated, but everything is open and fully operational. I don't believe we saw any stores closed here, whereas at Fisherman's Wharf there were a ton of stores closed, stores and restaurants, and we thought maybe Sundays or Mondays they're closed, but nope, they were just closed for good because of COVID. Now, another amazing restaurant that we tried was Katsuya in the downtown area. They are a Japanese katsu sando restaurant in a little international market mall. We got two sando plates. Both of these were about $15, and look at all that food. This is the chicken cutlet katsu, and the other one is the cheese and pork katsu. They both come with the coleslaw, the dumplings with kabocha, which is like a Japanese squash, and the macaroni salad. Service was amazing, the owner is super nice, all the food was fantastic. And then we came over to the famous Ferry Building to get some dessert. There is the famous Humphrey's Slugcombs ice cream, I hope I'm saying that right. And we tried the Vietnamese coffee and secret breakfast. Definitely a great option, and I highly recommend this over the other soft serve place. For $8, you can either get a crappy cup or cone of soft serve or a great cone, waffle cone of ice cream. So take your pick. If you head down Fisherman's Wharf towards the Ghirardelli Factory and Ghirardelli Square, there is a small beach area with a pathway. We took a trip down here a few times just to get some fresh air and walk off all the food we were eating. And in between the beach and Ghirardelli Square, there is this massive park. There were always people just sitting, hanging out, walking their dogs, playing with them, playing fetch, and you take that hill up and you get to Ghirardelli Square. Of course, there are, I think, two or three actual Ghirardelli shops that you can buy the chocolate and ice cream sundaes and drinks or whatever it may be, and souvenirs, of course. There are also other restaurants and shops in the area. Now, the Ghirardelli chocolate store is, I don't want to say overpriced, but it's not really worth it to buy anything there because you can get the same chocolates at your local supermarket or Walmart, wherever they sell it, for probably cheaper, if not the same. And most of the time the markets will have sales, so then in that case you will get them for cheaper. So unless you want to buy some specific souvenir or maybe a few specific items like clothing or a cookbook that you may not find elsewhere, I don't really see it as worth it. Of course, I went in with the mindset that we're here, we should buy some chocolate, but after looking at the prices, it's just, you know, might as well wait for the holiday sales at Costco or something. But what's really cool is they show you all the old school chocolate making process with all the machinery and chocolate processing that they have. I'm not sure if they actually use this because all the chocolate is in the open. I don't think so. They probably just have it as a display piece, but it was still really interesting. I had never seen or paid attention to that before. But it was something for chocolate lovers or baking lovers. Any, you know, if you love sweets, this is definitely the place to go. And of course, all the chocolate options that you will see throughout the shops.
Pretty sure the house behind me is Mrs. Doubtfire's house, 2640 Steiner in San Francisco. So I'm gonna look it up just to make sure. I didn't have a chance. We had to park in the red. I'm pretty sure that is the house.
Now, one more movie scene area. This is actually the ending from the Ant-Man and the Wasp.
I got the lab. Air feels chunky.
Oh no, he's too big.